God. Once again, thank you for worshiping with us today. Antioch members, please stand and welcome our guests.
So now that you have been welcomed and you've heard our worship, we thank God again that you're joining with us. Like I said before, is that I hope that you are able to connect. This is an opportunity for you to connect with our church. So many of us are disconnected. So many of us are disconnected from each other. And then sometimes when we're disconnected from each other, we feel as if we are disconnected from God. And so what today I want to do is I want to be able to let you know that there are various ways you can connect to our church. One way is through our email address, which should be coming up at the bottom of the screen, is our email address. It's Antioch Progressive Church. And you should be able to contact us via that. If you have any prayer requests, if you have a need that you might experience in your life, if you just want to reach out and maybe get some encouraging words, if you would like scriptures or whatever it is that you might need in this time, if you're in the Sacramento area and you want to know about our food giveaway and food distribution, whatever needs you may have, we want you to connect with us and know that we're here to connect with you. We also want you to know that you can call on our prayer line and receive prayer. We want to put up our prayer line number so that way you can write that down, you can put that in your phone, however you want to do it, and you can connect with us via prayer every Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. But right now is a time that you can connect and help support our ministry so that we can continue to do what it is that we do. Continue to meet the needs of our community. Continue to meet your needs. And so what we also offer is for you to mail in your offering. Our mailing address should be coming up to the left of me, and you should see our mailing address. You can mail your tithes in. What we also want you to know is that even if you want to mail your tithes in, what we're doing here at the church to make it easy for you is that we are actually sending out self-addressed envelopes to us at the church, and we're putting the postage on there. And in that package of envelopes is also included a message and a sermon outline from our pastor that you can study throughout this virus. It is specifically tailored to this situation of our senior pastor has written it. So if you would like to receive that information, if you'd like to mail in your tithes, use the address on the screen. If you want to receive that sermon, you can call us, email us, you can reach us at our webpage. It's now time for us to give. Giving is not something that we do because we are obligated. Giving is a joy for us in the Christian faith. We sow seeds in the hopes and the knowledge that when we put a seed in good ground, that it will grow and produce and feed us and our family. When you give to this ministry, God blesses you. It's not about us. It's about you and your relationship with God. So now if you would go to the church app, which is at church ministry one, churchapp.com, and you would go there and you would look at the church app, and you can give that way. You can go on our webpage and give via PayPal. You can mail in your donations, but now we're going to have a song selection and worship as you log off and go give. So we appreciate all those who have been giving. Your offerings and givings have been receiving, and they have been blessing us to continue to move forward. So let me pray over the offering before you give. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you, God, that you are here to bless. Father, we ask, God, that you would continue to worship with us today. That, Lord, as the music begins to play, God, that you would begin to move the atmosphere where people are. That, Father, as our praise team prepares to bring the next selection, that, God, you would bless us and bless the giver. Bless every seed sown that it would produce in their life, not just in our church, but in their own personal families. Father, give peace and guidance in this time, because you said that when we give our tithes, you rebuke the devourer. You come against what comes against us. And we ask, God, that as we sow, you do your part. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I look up to you. Thank you.
deserve it. All the praise, all the glory. Father, we come right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, thanking you because you deserve it. Regardless of circumstances and issues in our lives, problems and things that come against us, God, you deserve it. So, Father, right now we ask, God, that you would give us a word because we've worshiped. We ask that in response to the worship that's been given, the songs that have been sung, the hearts that have been lifted, that God, you would give to us instruction. Give us something that will change our lives. And God, we pray that right now in the name of Jesus, that every word, every action, every deed would bring you glory. Fill me, God, that I may overflow in your people. And Lord, use my mouth that I may speak. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Good morning to you again. For those who may just be joining in right at time for the word, what I want to do is we're going to be coming today from Luke chapter 8 and verse 4. Luke chapter 8 and verse 4. But I don't want it on the screen just yet. I just want to really just kind of have you look it at me. Luke chapter 8 and verse 4. The thing that I want to do is I want you to understand where this comes from, right? In our day and age, in our times where we live today, we know that we are dealing with unprecedented circumstances. And one thing that my wife and I were having a conversation, and she began to talk to me and tell me that, hey, you know what? There is a lot of mental and psychological and emotional pressure where people are saying to other people via social media or via online or via sharing, whatever way they're doing it, texting, that, hey, you know, with this time, you should come out of this with a book, or you should come out of this with a business, or you should come out of this with something grandiose. And it creates a sense of pressure. It creates a sense of a push that she said sometimes makes people feel more depressed. That people in this time are feeling as if you should come with something and they're just trying to psychologically get over or get past where they are. We know that in times like this, I've been hearing on the radio that there's been pleas out to people who suffer from domestic violence. That as you're dealing with domestic issues, that domestic violence in times of shelter in place continues to go up, that abuse of women and children, that they don't have escapes to be able to get away from work to work or to school, and that they need help. We see that folks who are sick, that if they get sick, that they go to the doctor, but yet the doctor tends to not allow family members there. So the healing process is a little bit hampered because we're not able to be with the loved ones that we have. There is so much pressure upon us to perform in the midst of unprecedented circumstances. But what I wanted to do today was I wanted to hopefully alleviate some of that pressure and begin to give you maybe some encouragement that you don't have to feel pressure to produce. And so what I wanted to do today was God been praying and God was dealing with me and I came to Luke chapter 8, and I want to read Luke chapter 8 beginning at verse 4. I'm going to read all the way through verse 15, and then we'll come back through it and we'll take it apart and we'll go back through it. But Luke chapter 8, verse 4, it starts from the New King James. It says, "And when a great multitude had gathered and they had come to him from every city, he spoke by a parable. He said this, a sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside and it was trampled down and the birds of the air devoured it. Some fell on rock, and as soon as it sprang up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. But others fell on good ground, sprang up, and yielded a crop 100-fold. When he had said these things, he cried, 'He who has an ear to hear, let him hear.' Then the disciples asked him, saying, 'What does this parable mean?' And he said to them, 'To you it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to the rest it is given in parables, that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand.' Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are the ones who hear, then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. But the ones on the rock are those who when they hear, receive the word with joy, and those have no root, who believe for a while, and then in times of temptation, fall away. Now the ones that fell among thorns are those who when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. But the ones that fell on good ground are those who having heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it and bear fruit with patience. Today, I wanted to deal with the fact that because people are struggling with this virus and struggling with the things that they're doing, that as these things come up, that we would do something in this season. I believe that those folks who are saying you should come out with a book, you should come out with a business, you should come out with a class, you should learn a new language, that they're pushing you in a season, but the problem is that we feel pressure and not upliftingness. And so what I want to do is I want to talk about today something that deals with that kind of thing. And my subject for today that now can go on the screen is protecting potential. Protecting potential. Protecting potential. When I begin to look at the scripture, the account of the parable of the sower is a very well-known scriptural reference, and people talk about the parable of the sower all the time. And the thing about it is that what I wanted to bring out of this and what God began to lay in my heart is that when I look at a seed, to me, a seed is untapped potential. See, when you place a seed in the ground, and if you've ever had an orange or an apple, and you've ever seen an apple tree or an orange tree, that seed inside the orange has the potential to become an orange tree, which can produce more oranges. The seed inside of an apple becomes potential to produce an apple tree that then produces more apples. And the thing about the seed is that the seed is untapped potential. But the reason why the seed is produced inside of the fruit is because it protects the potential. Somebody watching today needs to understand that the reason God has you sheltered in your house, the reason that God has you on that job, the reason that God has you in your marriage, the reason that God has you a member of your church, the reason that God has placed you in your community, the reason that God has given you that organization, the reason that God has did that is because God has encased the seed of his potential within you. And you are the potential seed, and he wants you to sprout and reproduce and grow and make bigger than what you are. See, an orange comes off an orange tree, but the seed inside the orange can produce a bigger tree than the orange is. In fact, a tree can produce from seeds, can produce multiple oranges just because of the fruit. And the problem is that too many of us forget that the potential and the push is not to there to bring us down, but it's there to help protect us. God places us in circumstances just the same way he places the baby in a womb, because it's not there to put pressure on the baby, but it's there to protect the potential that is held within it. What has God put inside of you that he is using in this season, that he's protecting you so that your potential will become full at the appropriate time and season? What is it that is in your life? Is it a book? Is it a business? Is it finances? Is it something? Is it a marriage? Is it something? Is it a relationship? What is it that God has placed inside you so that your potential can be fully tapped? See, I understand that as I sit even at my house, I'm not here at the church all the time. I'm in my house about 6 days a week, and I only come out a couple of times to just come to church and do Bible study and to do church, and then maybe on Fridays once in a while. But I'm used to being out of my house, and I'm in this space, and what I'm seeing is that in my space, things are becoming cluttered. Like papers are being put places, and I'm not cleaning up the things that I should. And what I'm understanding is I'm hearing the pressure of people saying, you know, while you're sitting here, you should be working on your business, or while you're sitting here, you should be finishing your book, or while you're sitting here, you should be preparing more messages, while you're sitting here, you should be getting ideas. And for me, it felt like someone was crushing me instead of encouraging me. But I come to tell you today that as I begin to read the word of God, I realized that what was wrong was not my circumstance, but it was my perspective on my predicament. That the way I looked at it was flawed. And the same way that Jesus speaks about this parable, he says, to you it has been given to know the mysteries of the kingdom, but to the rest it is given in parables, that seeing they may not see, hearing they may not understand. God says that his people who are called by his name have the ability to pull back and change their perspective on their situation. Somebody needs to know that your perspective has to shift, and you can't look at it the way you've already looked at it. You've got to change what it is that you're doing, because if you don't change what you're doing then and how you're seeing it, then you'll never pull out of it what's already in it. See, some of us, we get to our apples, we get to our oranges, and we cut out the seeds, and we take the seeds and we throw them in the sink and we throw them in the trash, and we say, man, I didn't want that piece, but ooh, the fruit is so good. And then we have to go to the store and buy another orange or buy another apple. But I want you to know that God is telling you that you shouldn't throw away what God has given you for your potential for your next level. That the things that you might be tossing out might be the very things that God has put inside of you for a season such as this. He's put protective barriers around you. He's got you in this position where you now have to use all that you have in order to get all that you got. I looked at this particular passage of scripture. I looked at it and I began to see that there were some principles that we could pull out of this particular passage of scripture. And I saw the principles were in the four environments. The four environments had different perspectives on the same potential. See, what I found out is that if the seed is our potential, if the seed being the word of God is the potential of God, once we get the word hidden in our hearts, that then we can receive, and I get all that, but if the seed is our potential, then the first place that we have to look is to the path. We have to look to the path and be able to see that the path is our first environment that changes what we are. And while we're looking at the path, we have to realize that the first thing that he said with the path is that people will pulverize your potential. There's a song that my daughter Jasmine likes, and it's called People. And I listen to that song, and sometimes it comes on and says, Lord, help deliver me from these people. The greatest gift you ever gave me and the greatest curse you've ever placed upon me is people. And they take and pulverize the things inside of you. What I want you to realize is that if you look at how people begin to pulverize what's inside of you, I put on there Matthew chapter 18 and verse 6. So if I want you to turn to Matthew chapter 18 and verse 6, because I want to read it to you really quickly about what it says. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him that a millstone be hung around his neck and he were drowned in the depths of the sea. See, I want to caution you that the problem that I see with most Christians is that we'll hear a message like this and we'll say, yes, Lord, I have potential and I need to watch the people that are in my path. I got to watch the people that are walking through my life. I got to watch the people that I interact with. I got to watch the people that come against me, because those people can pulverize my potential. But the thing about it is that sometimes you have to realize that you're a pulverizing force in someone else's life. Sometimes you snuff out other people's dreams. Sometimes people come to you with their ideas, and all you can say is, I'm trying to help you see the full picture, and they're just birthing something. You don't grab a new baby and throw it on the ground and talk about what's wrong with it. You grab a baby and you put it in an incubator. You heat it up. You nurture it. So sometimes you got to recognize that you're a pulverizer in somebody else's life. You got to be careful about your interactions is what I'm saying. You can't let anybody into your vision space. You can't let anybody tap your potential. But you also have to be careful when other people allow you into their potential. Because people will pulverize your potential. See, with the individual of it is that when Jesus talks about, he says that the seed fell among the road and the people started stepping on the seed and pulverized it and pushed it into the ground, that they knocked out all the potential before it ever got a chance to get started. The other thing that I saw was that not only was it potential, was it people, but it was also systems that suppress your potential. See, he said that the birds of the air would come and it received no moisture. He talks about how the birds of the air come and devour. See, when I look at those birds, see, the people were not a part of the system. But no matter where you go, as long as you're outside, the birds are a part of the system. And we have to realize that some of our suppression of what we deal with has to deal with the fact that systems come against your potential. Sometimes you can't plant your potential in the wrong systems. You can't plant your potential on the wrong job. You can't plant your potential in the wrong relationship. You can't plant your potential in the wrong church. You can't plant your potential in the wrong house. That's why we always say you got to pray before you do anything, because you got to seek God as to where is the place that I should plant my potential. Where should I put my heart? Where should I put my efforts? Where should I put my soul? Because if you know where to plant it, then you don't have to worry about the system suppressing it. See, when I looked at that, I realized that there are places in our lives and that we begin to deal with the potential. And the Lord led me to Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12, where it says this. It says very plainly in Ephesians chapter 6, it says, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." Sometimes the problem is not the people. Sometimes the problem is the system of sin in this world. I want to take you back just a little bit and kind of let you know that if you're dealing with sin in this world, that what people have been asking is, they're saying, where is the virus coming from? Where is things coming from? Where is all this dealing with? What are we doing with this thing? And how did it all get here? And I want you to know that what we're confronting is the broken system that sin brought into the world. If you look in Genesis, when God created Adam and Eve, there was no sickness, there was no disease, there wasn't even death. They were supposed to live forever. But because of sin, the system got broken. And now that the system is broken, sickness has entered, death has come about, selfishness has entered. All those things are results of a systemic issue, and the issue is sin. And so if you're dealing with a sin systemic issue, it will snuff out your potential. What are you saying to me, preacher? Well, I'm telling you that maybe it's not an external system. Maybe it's the sin system in your own self. Maybe it's the fact that you are dealing with sin in your own life. Maybe because you're dealing with pornography. Maybe because you're dealing with lying. Maybe because you're dealing with cheating. Maybe because you're dealing with a sexual issue. Maybe because you're dealing with something that God has said in His Word that is against His Word. And now you've got a sin system sickness that will not allow your potential to produce in its season. Some of us have to realize that what we're dealing with is systems in our own self, systems around us, sinful systems that are suppressing our potential. But then the next environment is rocks. See, Jesus said that sometimes that the seed fell among some rocky places. And when the seed fell among rocky places, the first thing we find out is that sometimes the supply is unstable. Sometimes when we fall among rocky places, the supply is unstable. See, he says, some fell among the rock, and as soon as it sprang up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. In order for seeds to grow, they can't just be in an environment that has nutrients, but it has to have water to be supplied. Some of us are so lost in our potential because we have lost the watering of God's word in our life. And we don't read our Bibles. Yes, I know I'm not a Christian. I don't read the Bible like that. I don't understand it. But the problem is that because you're not watering the word, your seed is not growing. Your potential is being stifled because you have an unstable supply. Well, I only read it when the Lord moves me. I only read it when I get in trouble. I only pray when I get here. See, your supply is not just built up in the Word of God, but your supply is in the church house. Yeah, I know you can't get to church right now, but there are plenty of church folk on this stream that you can chat with and say, hey, I need somebody to pray with me. That's why we have the prayer call, so you can get accountability. That's why some folks, they have in the Bible studies that you do online that you can partner up, because you need people to help you fulfill your potential. Not rocky, unstable, polarizing people, but you need solid, foundational, built on the Word of God people to help build in your life and not tear you down. See, in order for you to have the fullness of what God has in your potential, you've got to get past the unstable supply and get to God, who is a stable supplier. There is a song by Smokey Norfolk that there's a speaking part that comes before, and as well, Pastor Jamal Bryant, he says, God will supply all of your needs. See, what we forget is that some of that old school stuff that our great-grandparents and grandparents used to talk about that God is the supplier of our needs means that God's supply is unyielding, it's unending, and it's stable and can be counted on. David said, I was young and now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. In the wilderness of life, the children of Israel got manna every single day for 40 years. God's supply is not unstable, but steady. What you need to know is that if you don't have a relationship with God, then your supply might be unsteady. Then the next thing is that not only do you have an unstable supply, but sometimes you need to change your relationship because you need a replenishing relationship. You got to recognize that sometimes you need to get the right folks in your life. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 26 begins to talk to us about the types of relationships that we should have. Ephesians chapter 5 and 26 talks about the marriage relationships. It says, husbands, nurture your wives. Pour into them. Because see, some of us are in unhealthy marriage and spousal relationships, and we're sitting there wondering why we can't grow our potential is because we're dealing with a spouse that's burying us and pulverizing us. But I challenge you that if you're in a marriage today, that you start feeding the potential in your spouse. Start flourishing. Because here's the thing. When you feed the potential and it grows, guess who gets the fruit first? The fruit falls first closest to the tree. Be the root of that tree and build them up. That way you can get the fruit first. Also, the other thing is that Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 14, talk about the church. You got to get connected with the right church. You got to get connected with the right church. If you're connected with the right church, it will build you up. Oh, the right church is not going to make you feel good every week. The right church ain't going to make you shout every Sunday. The right church don't have the best singers all the time. The right church don't have the sweetest playing musicians. The right church is the place that's going to help you fulfill your potential. It's going to give you space to grow. It's going to challenge and push you and stretch you. It's going to give you the word of God, not opinions of man. That's the right church you need to be in. When you get in those relationships that replenish, then when your supply is low, when you feel like your source has been cut off, you can get in the house of God. You can get with the people of God and you can fulfill your potential. The last and the third environment that is a negative environment is the environment of the thorns. The environment of the thorns. The first thing is that we have to realize that when we get in thorny environments, he says that distractions are destruction. Distractions are destruction. When you read the text, you begin to see here that when Jesus begins to explain those that fell among the thorns, in verse 14, he says, the ones that fell among the thorns are those that heard and go out and are choked with cares, riches, pleasures of life, and they bring no fruit to maturity. See, this is where he's talking to those who go to church every Sunday and pray all the time. But yet, as soon as a trial or a tribulation, as soon as a hard circumstance comes, you step away from the God that you so richly served. You begin to find out that you didn't have the roots that you thought you did. You didn't have the depth that you thought you had. But now you're being challenged. And because you're being challenged, you're crumbled. You can't crumble under the challenge. You've got to survive. You got to thrive. You got to bend, but you can't break. You got to turn and twist, but you can't give up. Because if you break under the challenge, then what happens is that the things of this world begin to choke you out. They choke out your potential, and you get distracted. You get distracted by chasing after money. You get distracted by chasing after spouses and significant others. You get distracted by chasing after things that have no value. You get distracted after chasing after cars and prestige. You get distracted chasing after positions. And all you need to realize is that when you get distracted, you get destroyed. Your potential is totally destroyed. You can't grow a seed. My wife, she's gotten into doing plants and she hasn't started one from scratch from a seed, but one thing I know is that if you plant a seed, it'll start to sprout even if you don't do anything. But unless you know how to take care of it and nurture it so the roots can get deep, then when the storms of life come, it'll blow over and it'll break. If you get distracted by other things, you can't nurture your seed roots and it will die. Your potential will die because you're distracted. The other point that I saw in that is that not only will distractions are your destruction, but also displaced desire. displaced desire. When you seek after other stuff, your desire is in the wrong place. I don't know about you, but maybe you're sitting there and you're saying, I want to do this because I want me to be great. I want to do that because I want my children to be great. But if you're not seeking the divine desire of God, then what happens is you miss out on all the things that God has for you. You miss out on the things that God wants to bless you. You miss out on the strength to endure in times like these. You miss out on the things that can build your life. You miss out on the things that will grow your marriage. You miss out on the things that God wants to give peace in the midst of the storm. You miss out because your desire has been displaced. You've taken what you should be focusing on God and you've put it over here and over there and you're scattered and you don't know how to get things done. You're wondering why you can't accomplish. You're wondering why you're not moving forward. And it's simply because you're in a thorny place and you've got all these things choking and distracting you from where you need to be. But see, here's the wonderfulness about it is that the next environment is the one we all want to put our potential in. I call it the environment of roots. He says, some fell among good ground. And as you look at the graphic on the screen, I want you to see that I showed you a tree and its root system below the ground. The thing that you will notice is that if you look at it, the roots are actually bigger than the tree on top. If you get your life grounded and you get your potential planted in the right soil, around the right people, getting the right focus, getting the right environment, getting the right nourishment, getting away from the systems that will destroy it, and you get your potential planted in the place of Jesus Christ. You get your potential planted in the Word. You get your potential planted in your heart connected to God. You get your potential watered by the Holy Spirit. You get your potential placed in the ground of the rich soil of God's favor and grace. You get your potential planted. You'll begin to see roots grow deep. Before you ever see something pop up on the top, your roots are growing. Anything that grows too fast is called a weed. But anything that grows slow and is stable is called a plant, a tree, and it's got deep roots. And if you get your roots down in the ground, then what happens is that you'll have all the things that God has told you. What you have to realize is that when you get ready, that you've got to move past whatever is distractions and destruction. You got to get beyond those things that have taken you out of where you should be. Because if you don't let your roots grow, you won't make it in there. You got to learn that you got to get your roots down in the ground. Look what he says. He says, the ones that fell on good ground are those who have, having heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it and bear fruit with patience. See, the last thing is that when your potential is placed in the right place, then what happens is that your life will start to reproduce. I put on there that you get a legacy. You get generationally. See, I've never seen a tree reproduce except another tree. And I've never seen an apple seed reproduce except an apple tree that produces hundreds, if not tens more apples than what it had before. One apple planted in the ground with its seed can produce a tree that can give you 40 or 50 more apples. It becomes a cycle effect. From that tree, if you plant all those apples, you then get an orchard. In just three generations, you went from one apple to a whole orchard. What is God trying to do with the potential that's inside of you? It's not just for you. It's for everyone that's coming after you. God wants to do more for those who are coming. He told Job, your ladder will be greater. What comes after will be greater than what is. I don't know about you, but I'm excited today because when I think about all that I'm going to do, all that God has accomplished, all that God has for me, that when that begins to take hold in my life, that everybody coming behind me, my children and my grandchildren, they will reap a harvest greater than what I sowed. They'll get more than what I had. And my life is a legacy, not of the things that I leave, but of the legacy and relationship with Jesus Christ. See, our family is going through the same thing that your families are going through, and we're getting irritated. We sometimes get on each other's nerves, and we need our moments, and we get out the house, and we go on walks. But I will tell you this, that being rooted in Jesus Christ causes my family to come together and to have a firm foundation so that we can produce in the next generation. We talk about when this is over, how we'll tell the stories of what happened, how we'll talk about the birthdays that we celebrated, and we'll share with our children and grandchildren of the ways that we made it through this time, that you've never seen a time like this, and we pray you never will. But let me tell you how to behave. Let me tell you some stories, so that way when you get in the circumstance, you'll be able to understand that whatever you do for Christ is what will last. And you can do all things through Jesus who gives you strength. And if you get your potential planted in the right place, plant your potential in the right place, and you'll get all that God has for you. See, when I looked at that, I came to Proverbs 13 and 22, where it says, Proverbs 13 and 22, it talks about how if you begin in this generation, that it will leave an inheritance for every generation to follow. No matter what you're going through, no matter what you've been in, whatever you plant in good soil, whatever potential you plant in good soil, it will take root and it will produce generationally. So what are you leaving behind you? What are you doing that makes it work for you? Are you leaving an inheritance for your children's children? Or are you storing up something else that will not be able to sustain you? See, I want to close with this, and then I'll be done, and we'll sign off from this broadcast. And I thank you for continuing to join us. But and it may be going a little long, but I just hang in there with a little bit. I was walking around my neighborhood, and as I walked around my neighborhood, I saw these oak trees. We have these beautiful 100-year-old oak trees, and because I live in Elk Grove, California, you'll see these trees. They're protected. You'll see them in parking lots. They can't tear them down. They can't cut them down. You have to talk to the city if you want to cut the trees and the limbs, because these trees predate us. They predate even Elk Grove, and they're a part of the history of the city. And one thing that I saw is that when I looked at these big, beautiful trees in the park down the street from my house, because there's so many of them in the park that were protected, as I look at these big, beautiful trees, I see how tall they are. And when I think in my mind that they're over 100 years old, I begin to see that the tree is rooted and grounded. Now, here's the part of it that really began to speak to me about what we're talking about today, is that protecting your potential. Is that sometimes we think that being rooted and grounded means that we can't adapt to our changing environment. It means that just because I'm rooted means I'm unchangeable, I'm unmovable. But see, that's not really true, because I thought back in my life and I said, when this tree first hit the ground, when it was an acorn, it first hit the ground, that tree, it was nothing around it but fields and maybe some more trees and some more acorns, and that tree was all by itself. And as time began to go on, we begin to build houses and things begin to progress. They put in water systems and sprinklers. They put up houses that had, they put in roads and cars. They put in sewer systems and cables. They begin to progress around the tree. And the thing that I realized is that as the houses begin to grow up and progress begin to go around the tree stayed firm in what it was rooted in. And here's what I found, is that when there's bad storms and bad seasons, that fences that are modern may blow over, but the tree still stands. Things that were there before it and came after it may fall over, but the tree, because of its roots, will still stand. It's taller than everything else in the neighborhood. It's standing above all of the progress. It can see how the landscape is changing, and because it's rooted, it can stand the test of time and blow with the storms. If you will get your potential in your life rooted in Jesus Christ, then when the storms of life come, when the issues come upon you, when situations try to press you and push you and pull you, when progresses begin to make, you won't be trampled, but you'll just stand tall. And you'll be able to see that God is still able to supersede what you think is able to happen. And everything that's in you may change and shift, but you'll be rooted and grounded and still standing. If the houses were to burn down, the tree would still stand. If the grass was to get torn up, the tree would still stand. If the road stopped working and cracked apart, the tree would still stand. Is your potential, is your life standing in Jesus? Is it standing in Jesus? Is it standing rooted in the Word of God? Is it standing and rooted in the Bible? Is it standing and rooted on this? Because I challenge you today that if your life is not rooted in God, that I give you the opportunity to root your life in God. It's as simple as ABC, and it'd be coming up on the screen for you. You admit, believe, and choose. Admit, believe, and choose. Admit that your life is not rooted in the right soil. Admit that your potential needs some protecting. Believe that God is going to protect your potential. Believe that God is a safe and sure foundation, and choose to take your life, to take your potential, to take your legacy, to take everything you have and plant it in Jesus Christ. I know it may be scary. I know it may be challenging, but guess what? You've planted it all kind of places. You planted it on pathways and people that hurt you. You planted it in rocky places and it didn't have enough supply. You planted it among the thorns and got distracted. Why don't you try Jesus and plant your life on Jesus? It starts with a simple conversation. You just follow those ABCs. You admit to God, God, I have my life all kinds of places. But Lord, I believe what the Bible says, and this preacher's been preaching about, that Jesus is different and I should plant my life in him. So Lord, I choose to open my heart and let Jesus in and allow him to plant my life in his word. And if you have said that in your heart and mind today and prayed what we call a prayer, which is just that conversation with God, then I believe that God has invited you into his family and you are what we call saved. And if that's you and you have done that, I invite you to send us an email. Our email address should be coming across the screen right now. And I want you to actually, when you put our email address on the screen, that you would email us and let us know, hey, you know what? I prayed the prayer with the preacher. I invited Jesus into my life. I want to know what the next step is. Even in this season, right where you are, we can help you build your relationship with God. Right, just by sending an email to that email address and let us know that God touched your life. And we will reach out to you and find a way to get you connected with our church so that when we come back together, I can't wait to see all the people that were watching us online that come to church and say, I've been watching you all throughout this virus and God has been dealing with me. And so I'm coming to make this my home. We can't wait for you to come visit us in your new home. We thank God for you. We thank you for tuning in with us today. I know that maybe it may have gone a little long, but I pray that God has continued to bless you. I pray that even right now, while you're getting prepared for the close of this broadcast, that you would continue to pray. Remember, I don't want you to forget that on Wednesday nights, we have prayer call at 6 p.m. with the number that's on the bottom of the screen. Make sure you call the number for the prayer call. Don't forget that we have Bible study right where you're watching us right now on Facebook to interact in the dialogue, or just watch us wherever you are, online, on your phone, wherever you are. We thank God for you, and we pray that God will bless you and continue to touch you as you go throughout this week. Let us pray. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for being God and for being a safe place for our potential. We pray, God, that in our potential, God, that you would let it grow and flourish, because it is you, oh God, who is the one who gives increase. It's you, God, not the people, not the preacher, not the church. It's you, God, who gives increase in our life. Father, I pray for every person, every heart, every mind, that you would bless, heal, deliver, set them free in this moment from anything that has them beset, anything that's blocking what you put in their potential. I pray, God, that you would heal them and uplift them, touch them. Let their lives be demonstrations of what they can do when they plant it in Jesus, and God will make a change. God bless you. We thank you for joining us. We hope to see you Wednesday evening. Have a good week.